is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to AFTD's Educational Webinar Series. Today's webinar is Stimulating the Brain to Preserve the Mind, Using Noninvasive Neuromodulation to Understand and Treat FTD, presented by Dr. Roy Hamilton. I'm Sharon Denny, Program Director at AFTD. On behalf of all of us here and Dr. Hamilton, I'd like to thank you for joining us today. Before we get started, I'd like to go over a few items to help you participate in today's event. Dr. Hamilton will present his information in three parts. Following each part of the presentation, there'll be an opportunity for questions. We ask that you submit your questions by typing them into the questions section, which is located towards the bottom of your control panel. Please send your questions as you think of them, and we will ask as many as possible at the end of each section. We will have you muted for the duration of the presentation. You can hear us, but we can't hear you. This helps to keep the background noise to a minimum so that everyone can hear the presentation clearly. If you have any technical issues, please write a message in the questions box and Bridget Moran McCabe or I will try to address the issue without interrupting our guest. Today's webinar is scheduled for 90 minutes. We are going to record this and we'll post it on AFTD's YouTube channel and website in the coming days so that a wider audience can see this presentation. For those of you who are meeting us for the first time, AFTD is a national nonprofit organization whose entire focus is on FTD disorders. Our mission is to improve the quality of life for people affected by FTD and drive research for a cure. We do this every day through advancing research, awareness, support, education, and advocacy. AFTD provides help and support for people diagnosed with FTD, for their families and friends, and the professionals that serve them. This includes providing accurate information via the AFTD website, a companion website for children and teens, and the only helpline in the country devoted to FTD. Each helpline call and email is answered by a specially trained staff member. AFTD provides support group facilitators in our national network with continuing education and support to meet the needs of FTD families in their community. We also offer unique opportunities for FTD support group leaders to network with each other. New facilitators are always welcome. Our ComStop grant program provides direct assistance for people to travel to an FTD conference or to access respite to recharge. A new pilot program helps persons diagnosed with FTD access goods or services that will enhance their quality of life. And finally, Partners in FTD Care is an education initiative for health professionals and family caregivers alike that provides case examples and strategies for managing care. So a couple of reminders. The first is we would encourage you to be sure to sign up for our newsletters, and if you aren't already getting them, so that you can stay informed with all the current news and activities here at AFTD. Volunteers are the energy behind everything we do. Whether you're living with FTD or caring for a loved one or a healthcare provider, join us in the important work of helping people who face these challenging disorders. To get involved, contact AFTD's helpline at info@theaftd.org. And coming soon, please save the date. Our annual education conference will be Friday, April 13th in Chicago. Please come and join us and colleagues from Northwestern University's Cognitive Neurology and Alzheimer's Disease Center for a wonderful day of learning and networking. And the next installment of our educational webinar series will be in February 2018, and we'll be sending more information out about this shortly. And now it's my pleasure to introduce our guest, Dr. Roy Hamilton. Dr. Hamilton is an associate professor in the departments of neurology and physical medicine and rehabilitation at the University of Pennsylvania, where he also directs the Laboratory for Cognition and Neural Stimulation. He's been engaged in research in the field of brain stimulation since 1998. He's employed transcranial magnetic stimulation and transcranial direct current stimulation in a range of studies that explore various topics, including, but not limited to, language production, cognitive control, visual spatial processing, semantic memory, and creativity. And so without further ado, I'm very pleased to welcome Dr. Hamilton, who will tell us about the very latest work in non-invasive technologies.
Great, thank you. I would like to thank the AFTD for giving me this opportunity to talk about the application of brain stimulation to frontotemporal dementia. As was pointed out, I run a noninvasive brain stimulation laboratory here at the University of Pennsylvania. The mission of what we work on is to try and identify structure function relationships in the brain and network function relationships in the brain as they pertain to human cognition, and then to try and take those insights and bring them to patient populations who have cognitive deficits as a result of neurologic disease. And one area of focus in the laboratory has been stimulation of patients with language disorders related to FTD. So I'll summarize some of that work, but also give a broader overview of work that's being done in non-invasive brain stimulation in FTD and related disorders. So here's our roadmap for today. I'm gonna start by introducing the audience to the two main workhorses of non-invasive neuromodulation. And those are magnetic stimulation of the brain and electrical stimulation of the brain. So we'll do a high level overview of what those technologies are like, what they are doing to the brain, and what kinds of changes we generally expect to see. Then we'll summarize some of the literature having to do with the use of non-invasive brain stimulation technologies for the treatment of frontotemporal lobar degeneration spectrum disorders. And most of the literature that we'll review will have to do with the treatment of language disorders, also referred to as primary progressive aphasias. But there will be a little bit of other literature on other manifestations of FTD, which we'll discuss as well. And then finally, we'll talk about recent literature that suggests that non-invasive brain stimulation technologies might be useful as diagnostic tools for assessing FTD, and in particular, as tools for disambiguating FTD from other neurodegenerative conditions. So to move to the first portion of our talk, as I said, the main tools of most brain stimulation laboratories and to what extent they exist, clinical practices, are magnetic and electrical brain stimulation. So the older of these two technologies and more established is transcranial magnetic stimulation. The basic idea behind TMS was actually discovered in the 19th century by Michael Faraday in 1831. And what he discovered, which is now referred to as the principle of electromagnetic induction, is that if you have a coil of wire, you know, something that's electrically inert, at least to start with, but conductive, and you pass a current through it, if you have another body, another object close to it, which is also conductive, right, you can generate current in that second object, even if that object is not touching the first. So that idea is known as electromagnetic induction. And the way it works is that as you are passing current through that first body, that creates a fluxing magnetic field. And as that magnetic field fluxes, it generates current in the second body, even if that second body is not touching the first. So transcranial magnetic stimulation exploits that property of physics. In this case, the second body that we keep talking about is the neurons in one's brain. So we take a coil of wire, we pass an enormous amount of current through it over a very short period of time. That creates a fluxing magnetic field. That magnetic field then generates current in the nearby neurons of the brain. Enough current that it can cause those brain cells to depolarize or fire. And we can demonstrate that actually by putting the TMS coil over the part of the brain which represents what's called the motor cortex, or the part of the brain that sends commands down to the body through the spinal cord to the muscles eventually and cause movement. Right? You can put the coil over the scalp, over the motor part of the brain, discharge it, and demonstrate that you can move cause those brain cells to fire and cause the body to move. In this case, in the illustration here, we're taking EMG or muscle recordings from the hand and causing the hand to move as a function of pulsing the brain, the part of the brain that represents the hand. So again, the idea here is we can non-invasively generate enough current in a focal manner, right? Not the whole brain, but just a spot on the brain that we're interested in, that is sufficient to cause brain cells to fire to elicit an immediate response. We'll return to this motor response that can be induced a little bit later in our talk when we talk about some of the tools for assessing what TMS is doing in the brains of patients. An important aspect of TMS is its focality, is the fact that we can use it to target very circumscribed parts of the brain, even though we are directing our stimulation from the outside. One important tool for doing that is non-invasive neuronavigation. So here's an illustration of a neuronavigation system. What you see here is on the pole in the middle of the screen is an optical position sensor, in other words, a camera that is detecting the position of the coil, which is placed on the subject's head, as well as the position of the subject's head, which is indicated by a head tracker, right? And we can use this information, we can use the positions of the subject and the coil in conjunction with pre-existing MRI data that we feed into software in order to direct the coil with a very high level of precision to the area of the brain that we wish to stimulate. So again, to summarize, we can direct brain stimulation with very high resolution. We can use brain stimulation in different patterns, depending on how frequently we give it, how long we give it for, and the patterns of stimulation that we use can determine whether or not the effects that we're seeing on the cortex, on the activity of the brain, is overall excitatory, in other words, leaves the brain after the stimulation in a more excited state, or if it's inhibitory, if after stimulation, the brain is less likely or less reactive. Right? And we can control that depending on how we administer our stimulation. And I'll give you an example of that a little bit later in the talk. That depends on the pulses, you know, again, how frequently we give the pulses, how many we give, how quickly or slowly, and the pattern in which we give the pulses. And so those are the kinds of properties that we use to determine whether or not we're going to elicit temporary or more enduring effects, excitatory or more inhibitory effects. The technology generally is quite safe to use. There is a very low risk of inducing a seizure. However, within the now very well established safety parameters of using the device, that is palingly uncommon. That is, in particular, in individuals who are not known to have seizure disorder. So it is, again, a very safe device. There is a minimal risk of inducing a seizure that we just do not see within our current safety parameters. Let's now switch very quickly to the other main technology that we use in non-invasive neuromodulation, and that is direct current stimulation, or tDCS. So tDCS involves applying current directly to the scalp, and by virtue of doing that, through to the brain. Right? And so as you can see from the illustration here, it requires at least a couple of electrodes, one or more of which must be a cathode, one or more of which must be an anode. Think of those as sort of the negative and positive charged ends of these electrodes. And when one places the electrodes on the scalp, you run a very small amount of current through them, and that current passes through all the tissues that are interposed. So that's going to be the skin, subcutaneous fat, bone, you name it. But one of those tissues is going to be the brain. So the brain is going to see a small amount of current. An important difference between TMS and tDCS is that tDCS is subthreshold. Remember, I told you that we could place the coil, the TMS coil, over the motor parts of the brain, and we could switch it on and use pulses to stimulate the brain to the point that cells could fire to the to such an extent that it could actually induce a movement. You cannot do that, or one does not do that, with tDCS. The current that is running through the brain, through the electrodes, is far too low. It's on the order of 1 to 2 milliamps. Right? What we think happens when we administer tDCS, in contrast to TMS, is that we are making incremental shifts in the resting membrane potentials of neurons. What I mean by that is that neurons, brain cells, have a resting state in terms of their electrical potential. And when they get pushed from that state to a certain point, a certain threshold, that's when they have their action potentials. That's when they fire. And what we think is that tDCS nudges large numbers of neurons a little bit closer to that threshold for firing, right? or a little bit further away, making it a little bit harder to that threshold for firing, but not that the tDCS acutely fires those neurons. The net effect of nudging those many, many neurons a little bit closer to their firing threshold is that over time, you tend to see an increased firing rate. The net effect of nudging those neurons a little bit farther away from their threshold is that over time, you tend to see a decreased firing rate. So we think that we have subtle effects on neuronal firing that are modulatory, that are seen over time. Now, I mentioned that the electrodes, because it's a circuit, you're basically creating a circuit when you put the two electrodes on the head, right? There's a plus end and there's a minus end, right? There's got to be at least one anode and at least one cathode. And the conventional wisdom, the received wisdom about the anode and the cathode, is that they have different effects on cortical activity and subsequently on behavior, where a number of studies have associated placing the anode over an area of brain of interest with facilitation of activity of that brain area, and a number of studies have associated placement of the cathode over an area of the brain with more inhibitory effects on brain activity and subsequently on some behaviors. I frame this as the received wisdom because there is some debate around this. The exact differences in what's happening on the brain are obviously the brain's very complicated, so it's not as simple as just a plus sign and a minus sign, but this is sort of the received teaching. tDCS has a number of practical advantages when compared to other technologies, including other brain stimulation technologies. It's inexpensive, an order of magnitude lower in cost than a TMS device. It's very safe. If I said that TMS had a very minimal risk of a known adverse effect, no study in which tDCS has been used appropriately has demonstrated any serious adverse effect. So, it is a very safe technology. And for practical reasons having to do with therapies, it's also a very useful technology because the technology is portable enough and can be attached to the head and can be used in conjunction with other activities, right? So you can imagine if you're wearing this device or one like it, that you could simultaneously engage in activities like physical therapy or speech therapy, occupational therapy, any one of a range of other activities. So I wanted to back up over this concept of different stimulation polarities having different effects on the brain, and just say a word about why that idea is present in the tDCS literature. So the what I'm showing here on the top right-hand side of the screen is a brain model that models the flow of current associated with giving tDCS. And if you can see those two silhouetted squares here, one seen in full view and one seen in profile, those represent where on the skull the electrodes would be. And here's the current that's being generated underneath. The idea here is that neurons are positioned in all sorts of different orientations. But on the surface of the cortex, a number of neurons are vertically organized with respect to topographically with respect to the cortex. And if that is the case, for those neurons, if you place an electrode, with a charge over the neuron, since there is a part of the neuron that's going to be closer and a part of the neuron that's going to be farther, let's take a look at that neuron right there. What you will get is charge separation in the neuron. So the part of the neuron that's closer to, say, a positive charge, well, then the negative charge will sort of collect near that end of the neurons, and then on the opposite end of the neuron, there'll be more positive charge. So because you can induce charge separation in neurons, the way the theory of tDCS goes, different parts of the neuron are more or less capable of, they're more or less influential with respect to nudging those neurons closer or farther away from their ultimate firing potentials. So for example, in this particular neuron, this area, the body of the cell, would be more important for eventually getting it to its firing threshold. And here you can see that if you place an electrode that is anodal or positive, that will cause a charge separation for this neuron, where there's more negative up here on this side of the neuron that's closer to it, right? Positive and negative tract. So the bottom of the neuron would be more positive, closer to, and this is the where you see more depolarization in an area of the neuron that is more important or has a more prominent role in whether or not that neuron is likely to fire. So that's the basic idea behind the notion that anodes and cathodes will have different effects, and it motivates a lot of the methodology behind different tDCS studies, although it's still controversial. The other thing I'll say about tDCS before I move on is that, in contrast to TMS, which is a very focal technology, so it's focal and stimulatory. We discussed how tDCS is modulatory, has a more subtle effect. It also has a more diffuse effect. So what I'm showing here is another set of models. This is, by the way, referred to as finite element modeling. It takes every kind of tissue in the MRI of a person's head and assigns it a conductivity and uses that to model how current would flow through the brain. And so this is a very common montage, a common arrangement of electrodes for giving tDCS. Right? And so using this very common arrangement of electrodes, what you can see is, if you thought that tDCS was very focal, you might expect that all the charge or most of the charge would be collected, or current, I should say, would be collected underneath the electrode, right? Underneath this in this particular model happens to be the anode. It turns out that when you model it, however, that's not the case, that you get a broad swath of current flow through the brain. Because remember that the current is just trying to get from one electrode to the other, and it's going to pass through all the tissues en route to doing that, right? And so so conventional tDCS ends up giving you a modulatory effect on the brain that is relatively diffuse. Now, you can control that to some extent depending on where you put the what's often referred to as reference electrode, in other words, the other electrode other than that somewhere else other than the area you were hoping to stimulate. However, it does remain the case that under conventional circumstances, under typical circumstances, tDCS is a pretty diffuse technology. I'll also mention as an aside that there are higher definition tDCS systems that use much smaller electrodes that you can distribute in a much more focal way. However, it remains the case that the bulk of stimulation that is still being done in research and in clinical studies that are underway is done with this conventional low resolution brain stimulation. So I want to summarize what I've talked about in the last 5 to 10 minutes about the differences between TMS and tDCS before we move on. TMS, again, has a very high temporal resolution. Remember, you're giving discrete pulses, so the temporal resolution there can be on the order of milliseconds. I mean, very small increments of time. For tDCS, it's over minutes, and because you're not acutely depolarizing brain cells, you're doing it over, you're modulating their activity over time. The spatial resolution of TMS is high, in the order of millimeters, and tDCS, and we're being generous when we're calling it centimeters, it's you know, as I showed you, pretty diffuse. The duration effects, that can really depend on how frequently, for both of these technologies, how frequently and how you stimulate and what you do along with stimulation. So, you know, we'll show you some examples in which TMS and tDCS were used to elicit very brief effects, but others in which they're used to elicit more long-lasting effects, which of course is what one is hoping for if one's thinking that the technologies might be used as therapeutically. We talked a little bit about how you localize in the brain using TMS and tDCS, that in TMS you use neuronavigation systems or other measurement systems for targeting what's a pretty focal technology, and that tDCS, again, because it's so diffuse, it's less of a pressing concern. Both the technologies are very safe. tDCS especially has no history of serious adverse effects, although it hasn't been around as long as TMS. There can be some patient discomfort associated with the two technologies. TMS, because it stimulates the peripheral nerves and tissues that are interposed between wherever you put the magnet and the underlying brain, sometimes you can get muscle twitching at the site of stimulation, which some people find uncomfortable. tDCS is its electricity, it's direct current, so sometimes people feel a kind of itchiness, a mild burning, tingling sensation of the kind that one can get when there's a little bit of an electrical charge. Again, usually both of these are well tolerated. Both of them have sham procedures, a placebo procedure. TMS involves a sham coil that looks and sounds like magnetic stimulation, although it doesn't give it doesn't induce an magnetic and therefore electrical current. And then tDCS has a realistic sham that involves turning on the machine very briefly and then shutting it off. While people are habituating to that sensation of stimulation, but then after they've habituated, they can't tell whether it's on or off. So that's how people administer placebo for tDCS. As I showed you, TMS is kind of bulky, so it's not really portable in terms of practical advantages, whereas tDCS is. It could fit into a slim briefcase. In terms of cost, again, there's sort of an order of magnitude difference. So there are some practical reasons why one might prefer the latter technology over the former. And with that, I'm going to take my first pause and see if people have questions before I move on to the next section.
Great, thank you. So we do have folks typing in a couple of questions. People are welcome to do that throughout. I'd first like to ask you a little bit of a historical question, because these are both technologies that have been used quite extensively and researched quite extensively in different disorders. So one of the questions we have is specifically whether TMS could be used as a treatment for someone with some motor symptoms, Babinski reflex or myoclonic jerks. But before you go to that real specific level, could you just say a little bit about how the two technologies have been used in other disorders for treatment sort of historically, and that's brought the field to using them in these specific ways within FTD?
Sure. So of the two technologies, TMS is older. The age of modern TMS started in the mid-80s. It was developed at the University of Sheffield by Anthony Barker. And many of its early applications have been in motor physiology and motor function. So to answer the question, to address one of the questions as I'm answering the broader question, there is some work looking at whether or not TMS can be used to modulate cortical hyperactivity or excess activity that is associated with some of the motor dysfunctions and more broadly some movement disorders as well. So there is work in that area. I will say, however, that in the history of TMS, it has a proven FDA approval for one indication, which is actually depression. So it we sort of moved out of the realm of motor physiology, although it's been explored in these areas I've just spoke about, as well as in all sorts of disorders where you would imagine that excess or depressed levels of cortical activity are suspect. So epilepsy in other areas. However, it's one main indication clinically right now since 2008 has been in the treatment of depression. tDCS is a much newer technology, although the concept of stimulating the brain with electricity has been around for a long time. The modern age of it started in the early 2000s with people like Nietzsche and Michael Nietzsche and Walter Paulus. They were in Germany, and it's been explored also for modulating a variety of different systems, including the motor system. So there is research into these areas, whether it can be used to modulate adventitious movements and abnormal motor signs. However, tDCS does not actually have a clinical indication to date. So not only would it be the case that any motor applications that one would discuss with tDCS don't have a clinical indication, none of the things that I'll discuss with tDCS, I mean, they're all sort of research-based at this point. But insofar as we know that both technologies can be used to manipulate motor activity, it is something that's still being explored.
Great, thank you. And from the diagram that you showed about the bigger, bulkier TMS setup, how big is the coil actually, if the result and the intent of that is that it's a much more focal type of intervention? Is the coil,
sure,
like your diagram, is that realistic for what it looks like? I would imagine that's an interpretation. So what is the actual coil that's delivering that charge?
Yeah, so the coil, the business end of the TMS unit is, you can design all sorts of coils for a variety of different purposes, right? So however, the most commonly used coil is about 70 millimeters in diameter. So that's actually not that big a coil, if you think about it. The key, however, is not the size of the coil itself, right? But if you think about it, what the size of the area is that is in which the magnetic field is strong enough in the brain to induce enough current to depolarize neurons. Right? So in other words, what's the size of the coil? What's the size of the area that you're stimulating in the brain underneath, right? And so with a 70 millimeter coil, again, the most commonly used coil, we think that's usually probably about a centimeter and a half maybe 1 to 2 centimeters. So think of the area of your thumbnail on the cortical surface.
Great, thank you. There's a question about cost. Now you mentioned that right now these technologies are used as research tools. So I'm imagining then that there's not much information about them being available or being covered by insurance or sort of cost in the commercial market. Can you just speak to that for a moment?
Sure. So CMS is used as a research tool. It has a clinical indication, so clinicians can purchase TMS units for the administration of stimulation specifically for the treatment of depression. Otherwise, both TMS and tDCS, the most commonly manufactured devices, are manufactured for the purposes of research. And so it would be difficult for an individual to find a device, a TMS device that was sort of directly marketed. It's easier to find a tDCS device that is directly marketed. There are devices that are currently on the market that are sold to individuals for different indications. They're generally, the ones that are they're direct to market are not advertised for clinical indications. The most popular and commonly used ones are actually marketed for enhancement, which I mean development of skills and abilities beyond, that in addition to what one would think of as ameliorating disease, so beyond just healthy, right? So, better than normal, if you will. There's a lot of debate around that issue. I could spend the rest of the time talking about just that debate. But I'll say that, there are anticipated and unanticipated risks that might be associated with direct-to-consumer brain stimulation. They fall into a number of categories, including risks we haven't realized about the device yet that are sort of general health-related risks, although they seem quite safe now. Risks of modulating your cognition in ways that you don't anticipate. That's one that I've actually written a fair amount about the idea that brains are pretty complicated. So modulating them on your own might lead to unintended cognitive consequences, particularly in brains that already have certain cognitive issues to begin with. So, they're out there. It's not clear that unsupervised stimulation is necessarily a salutary way to go for everyone's brain.
Great, thank you. And I think that's a good segue into the next section of your talk.
Yes, okay, great. So let's take a few minutes now to talk about the use of non-invasive brain stimulation in different clinical disorders, but I'm gonna focus now that the largest clinical section of this talk is actually going to be in primary progressive aphasia, so progressive language difficulties, because that's where most of the research that has involved FTD-related symptomology, this is where it's been with respect to non-invasive brain stimulation. So I'm going to take a quick second just to remind ourselves about where the language disorders, where these primary progressive aphasias fit within the context of frontotemporal lobar degeneration or FTD spectrum disorders. And so what I'm showing here is a review article, or I should say a figure from a review article by a colleague of mine from several years ago. And what it highlights is basically in the spectrum of frontotemporal lobar degeneration disorders, what kinds of symptoms that patients have with respect to their cognition. So, for example, under deficits of social cognition, if you look down there into the colored layer, you see that that's associated with the phenotype that we think of as behavioral variant FTD, right? Frontotemporal dementia that affects behavior very broadly. And then there's a family of impairments that are associated with language, right? And so those can be broken down into patients who have more fluent language disorders. In other words, their speech isn't halting, hesitant, agrammatic. It sort of comes out relatively fluidly, but there's something wrong with their language, their access to language. And then the non-fluent disorders, where the problem is that they are halting and hesitant, and there's something wrong with the grammar as they're trying to speak. And there are three currently identified phenotypes or ways people can present in terms of their symptoms that in the broad family of primary progressive aphasias. And those are non-fluent agrammatic primary progressive aphasia, what's called logopenic variant primary progressive aphasia, and semantic variant primary progressive aphasia. And then there are also disorders in the FTD spectrum, which involve not just cognition, but then also motor symptoms. We're not gonna dwell a lot on these today. I'll touch on one such syndrome, but they can include the high correlation with ALS, motor neuron disease, and then the fraction of patients who present also with extrapyramidal symptoms. In other words, symptoms that look Parkinsonian in nature. So decreased or increased rigidity and decreased sort of amplitude and speed of motor action. One other aspect I will point out in this figure is that we can also categorize these by the relative frequencies of different kinds of underlying cellular pathologies. In other words, if we looked at these brains under a microscope, what would we find? And so for some of these disorders, we are likely to find a particular pathology of FTLD that is tau, the tau protein. For others, we are more likely to find the pathology of TDP43, that protein pathology. And in others, in some of these cases, we're likely to find the pathology that is normally associated with Alzheimer's disease. So now I'm going to point to this middle line here, this middle row, and point out that these two top disorders, FTLD, tau, and TDP, right, we would think of these as FTDs with FTD pathology. And you can see that certainly behavioral variant FTD, most patients who present with that phenotype of behavior have one of those pathologies. Most patients with non-fluent agrammatic PPA have FTLD tau, so I think it's fair to say that that's generally going to be a kind of FTD presentation. I'm going to skip over here to semantic variant PPA. They tend to present with FTLD TDP43, whereas for the patients with logopenic variant PPA, they're going to present most commonly with Alzheimer's disease pathology. So when we see that variant, that aphasia, we're more likely to think that that patient is likely to have underlying Alzheimer's disease. Reason I mention all that is that for the next 5-7 minutes or so, I'm going to focus on non-fluent agrammatic PPA and semantic variant PPA with a little discussion of logopenic thrown in, but understanding that these two are the syndromes that are more commonly associated with FTD pathology. So let's outline what those primary progressive aphasias, what they look like, both in terms of their symptoms and also in terms of where you are likely to see changes in the brain. So this comes from an article that discusses the correlations between symptoms of PPA and brain changes. And what it shows is maps of atrophy in patients with the different PPA syndromes. Okay, so here you can see primarily in the inferior frontal gyrus. I should take a step back before I say anything else and say that for most individuals, almost all individuals who are right-handed, and in fact, most individuals who are left-handed, language is dominant in the left hemisphere. All right, so these PPA syndromes, all of them are going to be characterized by some kind of progressive injury taking place in the left hemisphere, although the right hemisphere may be affected too. At least the left hemisphere is going to be affected in order to give people aphasia. So getting back to our non-fluent PPAs, you see atrophy in the inferior frontal gyrus, so the lowest part of the frontal lobe. And for patients with semantic variant PPA, they tend to have more problems in the temporal lobe, right? The more anterior temporal lobe, they can actually get it on both sides. And for patients with local penic variant PPA, they tend to have their volume loss more posteriorly, superior temporal lobe. The temporal lobe sort of extends all the way back here. So posterior, superior temporal lobe, inferior parietal lobe. And so these different localizations actually have implications for the kinds of symptoms that people are going to have. And if you'll forgive me for a moment, I'll digress just to talk about the organization of language in the brain in very broad terms. All right, so the language system, here's a representation from a review article from a number of years ago on a diagram, or at least one model of how language is organized in the healthy brain. And I'm not going to go through it in detail. I'm actually just going to make one observation, which is that there's a difference functionally in many ways between what seems to happen in the brain with the more northern route, if you will, so more dorsal pathways, compared to what happens in the more southern route, the more ventral pathways. And to lump these concepts together, one could say that the dorsal part of the network seems to have a lot to do with the composition and, to some extent, control of language. That patients who have problems that are more, in these blue areas, they tend to have more problems composing their language and as well as their grammar. So whereas patients who have more problems in the southern route, right, more ventral pathway problems, they tend to have more lexical semantic difficulties. And by that, I'm referring to difficulties with word concepts and word meanings, right? So there's the what of words, basically, what do these words mean? And then, how am I going to execute the necessary actions in order to both in terms of grammar and also motor control in order to articulate those words. Right? And so if you think back to the map of the different PPAs and where the atrophy are, the atrophy patterns are, you can imagine the kinds of deficits that these different patients will present with. But let's go ahead and go through it very briefly. So patients with non-fluent agrammatic variant PPA, they've got atrophy here in this more dorsal part of the network. So their problem is characterized more by a composition and control problem. So they'll have more phonological errors, so errors in the actual execution of their speech sounds. Their grammar is impaired. It's hard for them to sort of organize the structure of their language at a level that allows them to articulate grammatically correct phrases and sentences. The speech is slow, it's hesitant. Generally speaking, because they don't have atrophy in the more inferior semantic centers, their comprehension of words is pretty well preserved. They can have apraxia of speech, in other words, disorder of the motor programs, the motor execution of the speech sounds rather than just the language itself. It affects both their speech and their writing. So, for instance, a patient who has a non-fluent agrammatic PPA might describe this scene as such. And I've actually, what I'm showing here is actually a transcription of a patient from one of my studies who's been asked in whatever words they want to use to describe this scene. So you can see that these are different utterances. The water is washing the dishes. She has a gookie jar. This is a phonological error here. It stand on. So it's not really... it is not an appropriate pronoun to describe this young man falling down. The cookie jar needs to be helped. So, grammatical problems, phonological errors, this is all in the context. This took some time, a considerable amount of time, much more than it took me to read it to you, for this person to articulate. So slow, effortful speech. You know, that's the typical phenotype of patients with non-fluent agrammatic PPA. Let's contrast that with patients who have semantic variant PPA. These patients are going to have problems with concepts and word meanings. And so they're going to have impaired word comprehension, right? They're losing access to what these words actually mean. And because they're having problems understanding what the meaning of the words is, well, it's very hard for them to name things, to come up with the right labels for concepts and for things that they encounter in their daily life and their environment. However, because the composition aspects of their language system, that more dorsal root, is relatively spared, they have relatively spared grammar and syntax. The sentences themselves are structured relatively normally. Because they have problems with semantic knowledge, they can often have problems with their remote memories, right? Your memories for things that happened a long time ago rely to some extent on your knowledge of sort of things in the world. And so, you know, you often see that these patients will have recent memories that are better than remote memories, which is a stark contrast, for example, to patients with Alzheimer's disease who prototypically, you know, very stereotypically have the opposite pattern of memory loss. So this is an example of the kinds of errors that patients can make when they have semantic variant PPA. Remember, they're losing access to concept knowledge and the names of things. So here, for example, is a behavioral test in which they're looking at pairs of stimuli, right? In this particular set of examples, they're looking at animals. And here they're being asked, which is the real animal, right? What they've done is they've transposed what the investigators have done, they've transposed some of the features of one animal to another, right? So real monkeys do not have giant ears like this, right? And real elephants don't have tiny ears like this. They, you know, these are monkey ears on an elephant, these are elephant ears on a monkey. So when you're asking a person who has strong concept knowledge, which of these is the real animal, of course they're going to pick the one that has all the features of the monkey, and here they're going to pick the one that has all the features of the elephant. But you see that patients with relatively mild semantic impairments, you know, they're going to have already, you see that compared to controls who get this task almost entirely correct, that they'll have some impairment, and as the severity of their semantic disorder worsens, that they eventually get down to chance, you know, that they're very impaired at being able to determine which is which, because they've lost these concepts, the concept of what a monkey is or what an elephant is and how it should appear. So switching to studies that have looked at PPA, there have actually been a small number at this point. This is from a review article that a trainee of mine and I wrote earlier this year. It was published earlier this year. And, you know, the number of studies listed in this table here is small but growing. Here, what's illustrated is these same studies up on top, these same studies, and where in the brain the investigators applied stimulation, either TMS or tDCS. So I'm not going to show you all of these studies, but I do want to show you some of the early ones and focus on some of the other ones that have some relatively unique features, and of course some of the studies that we've been doing in my lab more recently. So this is one of the earlier studies. And there are more studies that employ tDCS than TMS. So I'm showing this because it's one of the only TMS studies in patients with PPA. This one focuses on individuals who have non-fluent agrammatic PPA, which also goes by the moniker progressive non-fluent aphasia. And so what they were doing in this study is that they looked at patients, they characterized where in the brains these individuals had atrophy. That's what's represented by these hot colors here, right? So you can see the patients with semantic dementia had it in the temporal lobe, more in the temporal pole. The patients with the NAPPA or PNFA, however you want to refer to it, are going to have more problems in the inferior frontal lobe on the left. Right? And so these individuals received high frequency TMS, which is excitatory in nature, with the idea of trying to increase the activity of that region of the brain. They did it only for a limited number of sessions, that the point was not to induce a permanent change in language performance, but to explore whether or not exciting these areas could have any effect on language performance. And what they showed here, what's being demonstrated here is naming tasks involving actions and objects. And what you can see here is that there was an increase. So TMS, they applied TMS to the right and to the left side of the brain, and they compared it to placebo, right, or sham TMS. And what's illustrated on the top is the patients with the progressive non-fluent aphasias. What's illustrated on the bottom is the patient with the semantic variant PPA, at that time referred to as semantic dementias. And what you can demonstrate is that for action naming, at least, that stimulation over the frontal lobes had a significant effect on action naming compared to placebo TMS, which was not true in individuals with semantic dementia, that stimulating this area of the brain where they did not have their impairment didn't seem to result in an improvement in their naming ability. Now, interestingly, these authors saw a change, an improvement that was temporary, in both cases, temporary, but also associated with stimulation of the right hemisphere. But importantly, there's a dissociation. We're stimulating over a region of the brain, you know, the frontal lobes, where patients with non-fluent achromatic PPAs have their degeneration seem to have an effect in this patient population compared to patients with their degeneration in a different area. So switching over to tDCS studies in PPA, this is a somewhat later, 2 years later, study by the same group. And they were looking at using stimulation again in patients with non-fluent agrammatic PPA. Here they're applying anodal tDCS, so what again canonically is thought of as excitatory tDCS, versus sham tDCS. And they're stimulating again over the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, so over that left frontal lobe, as one would expect in patients with NAPPA. Stimulating for 25 minutes, 2 milliamps. Here they applied stimulation once a day for 2 weeks and had individuals performing language therapy during their stimulation. And this time they examined the effects after 2 weeks and 12 weeks. And what they were able to demonstrate is that individuals getting anodal tDCS compared to individuals who were getting sham tDCS showed a significant benefit 2 weeks and 12 weeks after receiving stimulation. And that's on a standardized test of aphasia called the AAT. Now, when they looked at items that they had trained their subjects on, they had a battery of naming items that they had trained their subjects on that was different than the AAT, and compared it to untrained items from their language therapy, they found, as one might expect, that individuals got better at the trained items. Now, importantly, individuals, so the light color here is those who got anodal tDCS. The dark color here is those who got sham tDCS. So what you'll see is that at both time points, both groups improved in the treated stimuli. In other words, as you might expect, from all that practice from doing speech therapy, they got better with the specific items that they practiced during their speech therapy. However, you could demonstrate that the individuals who received anodal tDCS got even better, that they got significantly better, that there was a significant difference in how much better they got, at least at 2 weeks, compared to sham. Now, if you look at the untreated items, and I'll take a quick aside to say that in terms of rehabilitative therapy, you know, looking at untreated items in therapy is kind of the gold standard, right? You want whatever your treatment is, whatever your training is in the language system, not just to apply to the few words you trained on. You want your gains to spill over into all sorts of words and all sorts of language abilities, right? So here they're looking at the untreated stimuli, and again, they demonstrate that there's a significant benefit. However, that benefit is not significantly different between your anodal condition and your sham condition. So, you know, some benefit here, a numeric benefit for from tDCS, but not a statistical benefit between the two groups, specifically for the untreated naming items. So, you know, an interesting finding and a limited success, but, you know, not all the results that one would have wanted to have seen. Shifting gears to a different kind of language ability. This is work by Zapkini and colleagues at Hopkins. This involves applying tDCS along with a spelling intervention. And here I'll mention that for most of the studies I'm going to show from here on out, there's a mixed population of patients. So this is actually a couple of NAPPA patients and a number of logopenic variant PPA patients. And what they're doing is, again, applying a spelling therapy while applying stimulation, so 1 to 2 milliamps, over the left inferior frontal gyrus. And this is a 3-week treatment looking at sham versus tDCS. And each of these patients crossed over such that they received each of the conditions. And they use quite elaborate and sophisticated analyses. For the interest of time, I'm showing a table with the analysis that I think is the simplest and most intuitive to understand, which is these are the patients here listed in this column, and it shows what order of intervention they got. And now what's being done is in this table is you're comparing where they got to with tDCS compared to where they were just before treatment. Okay, so they're baseline treatment to post-stimulation performance. And so what you can see is that and you can do that with tDCS and with sham, right? So just to be clear what that would mean, the significant values are darkened here, okay? So that would mean for this particular pair, let's say of untrained items, there was a significant change from baseline for tDCS, but in the sham condition, there was no significant change from baseline, right? And so what you can see overall, as you look at immediately after stimulation, 2 weeks following stimulation, 2 months following stimulation, that yes, there were general improvements for both tDCS and sham, especially for trained items, you can see in many of these patients, less so for untrained items, but that on average or overall, you can see that the tDCS, both for trained and untrained items, it tended to be the case that in the tDCS condition, there were more significant improvements from baseline than when patients were in the sham condition. Right, you see that the shading there is more present in the tDCS columns than in the sham columns across all the three time points. All right, and so again, this is the crudest way of showing this data. They actually did very elegant and elaborate analyses, but makes the point that for across these patients, you're seeing more effects of tDCS than you are of sham in this stimulation and spelling intervention. So this is a different intervention. This is actually work with colleagues of mine at Temple. And here they're looking at semantic feature training in patients who have dense anomia. So that is a dense problem or a severe problem coming up with the names of things, which can be, you know, very problematic for patients with language disorders. So since this is we're focusing on naming difficulties, you'll remember that individuals with semantic variant PPA have these problems with sort of concept and object knowledge. So they're going to have pretty severe naming problems. So this population is more SVPPA, although there is one LVPPA and one AD patient who has anomia in this population. And here what they're doing, it's an open label study. What they're doing is they're training individuals by taking about 100 familiar objects and training them on the semantics of those objects. So let's say it was your toothbrush. You know, what is this? What do you use it for? When do you use it? They're basically training people up to become familiar with the features of those objects. Moreover, the investigators would go into the subject's home and take digitized pictures of those things. So it's not just, what is this? This is a toothbrush. This is your toothbrush, right? And you know, if you're talking about familiar individuals, like, these are the people you know. And so training people up to recognize the features of these different categories of things. And what they can demonstrate is that when they pair this particular kind of training with left parietal stimulation, again, anodal stimulation, over 2 weeks, that for the trained items, no surprise really, they are better with the trained items than they are with the untrained items. But you can, if you analyze the data, you can actually look at it. This is averaged data over here, so mean data, mean accuracy with these items. And this is individual data. So each one of these lines represents one of the patients in the study. And what you can see is that on average, it isn't just that that they were better. They also had a slowed rate of decline for those objects on which they train compared to the untrained objects, which I think it's easier perhaps a little bit to see with the naked eye, that there's more of a trend of sustained performance compared to most of these individuals who are actually trending downward by the end of the study, right? And so this gives at least some encouragement. Now, this is not a sham controlled study, so I think future studies will look at whether or not you can see these kinds of effects and whether it's really the tDCS that's doing it, whether it's the semantic feature training that's doing it, or some, or whether it's really the combination of the two. And so this leads us to some of the work that my lab has been doing recently. My lab's initial work has been a little bit less focused on some of the specific symptoms and specific targets with respect to neuromodulation in patients with PPA. And the reason for that is theoretical to some extent. My lab is interested not just in the therapy itself, but also in mechanisms of plasticity. And we are in the process of pursuing studies to try and sort out whether or not the best place to stimulate is actually the area of degeneration for a particular patient, or whether it's better to try and enhance the activity of the rest of the language circuit in order to try and induce compensatory changes in the organization of the language system. So because that's, you know, we proceed from the idea that the language system might be plastic, we actually try to stimulate as much of the language circuit, or tried to, in our early work as possible. So you can see here, here's the finite element modeling for our montage. And you can see we're trying to hit the entire pericilium, the entire left hemisphere language circuit with our stimulation. And so we brought in patients. Our patients were non-fluent, so four of them were LVPPA with two NAPPA, and we were stimulating them for 10 days and following them up at 6 weeks and 12 weeks after stimulation. And these are our open label results. They were quite encouraging, although there was some variability, pretty significant amount of variability is indicated by the error bars. In the domains of language that we were interested in measuring, speech production, repetition, grammatical comprehension, semantic processing, overall we saw a trend towards improvement. And if we collapsed all these measures into a global performance measure, well, we saw a significant improvement in our patients who were stimulated, again, in this open label study, when we compared where they were at the follow-up time points compared to their baseline. Right? Now, we've started following this up with sham-controlled stimulation, or sham stimulation as a placebo control. And as you might expect, when you move from an open to a placebo control study, the magnitude of the results that we get are not as robust. However, we still do get effects. And most importantly, I think for the results that we are getting, we see an interesting dissociation where when we look at the baseline performance of our patients before we administer stimulation, and we think about which patients are more severely affected, and contrast those patients from patients who are less severely affected in terms of their language performance, so either low performers or high performers. What we see is that low performers, individuals who did less well on our baseline testing, that they show a significant improvement across our measures, on many of our measures, and in our global performance measure once we collapse it, whereas patients who start off with relatively mild symptoms actually show do not show significant improvement in their symptoms at the immediate follow-up 6 week or 12 week time points. And you know, we think that that's very interesting. One of the reasons why we think that's interesting and to some extent encouraging is that if you look at language therapies, conventional language therapies, it actually tends to be the case that response to conventional language therapies goes in the opposite direction. You expect the patients who are more mildly affected can really engage in the therapies robustly, you know, rehearse them, maybe rehearse them on their own. These tend to be the people who improve more, and the patients who have really severe language impairments tend to show less robust improvements in their language performance. So it's encouraging that we have at least some evidence that these interventions can be effective even in patients who are more severely impaired. So I'm going to stop right there before I go on to the last sections. The last two sections are actually, the next section is very short, and then the last section is a little bit longer, so I might take them simultaneously. But I'll stop for questions now.
Great. Well, thank you. And actually, even in anticipation of your kind of review of the studies, one of the questions wanted to go back to, one of our folks knows that there is an ongoing study in tDCS at Johns Hopkins and in PPA. And so could you just speak a little bit further to how your current work varies from the studies currently at Hopkins?
Yeah, so the current work at Hopkins, I mean, it does key off of that work that I was showing you with the spelling intervention. I'm sure there are other ways in which that work has been elaborated more. There are a lot of overlaps between what that group is, how that group is approaching their work and what we're doing. I think that we are less specifically focused on that domain. Right now, what we are doing is we're inviting subjects to come in for what's called constraint-induced language therapy. It's a language therapy that sort of forces people, well, forces is such a rough term. It constrains one to use verbal responses. So we're hoping to use that as an improved way to facilitate fluency in patients who are getting stimulation. So, you know, there's a difference in the therapies that are being offered concurrently with stimulation. The basic approach to doing stimulation is pretty similar. You know, the method of the tDCS itself, I think, is pretty similar. The other thing we're interested in now is, again, and I believe, I don't know if either the Hopkins group or any other group, frankly, is as interested in this topic. One thing that we're particularly interested in now is this notion of understanding whether or not the best area to stimulate is the area that is most atrophied, or whether the rest of the language system is the most fruitful area to stimulate. So I think there is that difference, because moving forward, we're going to be directly comparing, or we plan to, and we're enrolling people in pilot studies that start to do this, comparing whether stimulating over the most affected part of the language system, most atrophied part of the language system, whether that's the way to go, which has been the uninterrogated assumption up to this point, or whether or not stimulating some other part of the system that is healthy enough to make compensatory changes, you know, whether that's the way to go. So that's going to be, I think, a difference between the two sites.
Great, thank you. We do have some more questions. I'm actually going to ask you to go ahead, and then we'll use whatever time we have at the end to cover the variety of questions that we have.
Okay, in the interest of time, I'm going to take the next two sections at the same time, because I'm looking at the time here. So it turns out, you know, there is far less, as I've alluded to, less data in other FTLD spectrum disorders then in the language system with non-invasive brain stimulation, I'm just going to cover a couple of studies. So as far as BV, behavioral variant FTD, you know, there, to my knowledge, I'm unaware of large controlled trials using non-invasive brain stimulation for this patient population. I think we're still at the level of case report literature. So here's one involving a woman who had progressive social impairment, impairments of executive function and other functional losses related to the degeneration. You know, you can see that the atrophy of her frontal lobes. And her investigative team gave her 10 sessions of tDCS over the course of a week, again, over the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. And, you know, although it wasn't not documented meticulously with quantitative data, they report on improved speech and functional engagement, as well as other functions. And by that report, that these improvements in function actually lasted, in their opinion, 7 months following the end of stimulation. And again, you know, at this point, we're talking about case report literature. I'm unfamiliar with any larger trials, but it'll be interesting to see where this literature goes and if larger trials can emerge. Another isolated study I want to point to is actually in patients with cortical basilar degeneration, which is in the family of symptoms and syndromes that patients with FTD can present with. So one of the things that makes this syndrome, characterizes this syndrome, is that many of these patients develop apraxia, motor apraxia, so that's the inability to execute learned motor movements. For example, as illustrated here, the ability to correctly salute or make some other complex gesture. And so here, the investigators stimulated over the parietal lobe, they actually stimulated the left and the right. It's worth noting that in the same way that the left hemisphere is thought to be dominant for language, there's some thinking that it has some preferential role in this in praxis as well, the execution of learned motor movements. And this is a study, it wasn't a long-term study, they were just comparing stimulation in these different montages to a single session of sham stimulation, and could demonstrate that that there was an improvement on a test of praxis with stimulation either over the left parietal cortex significantly over the left parietal cortex, numerically over both the left and right parietal cortex. It's worth noting, because the left hemisphere is thought to be more dominant for praxis, that stimulation of the left parietal cortex was associated with improvements both in execution of movements in the left arm as well as execution of movements in the right arm. So again, in the interest of time, I'm going to switch right into this last section on using non-invasive brain stimulation to diagnose FTD. In order to do this, I have to return to what I was talking about earlier in the talk about the use of TMS to assess motor output. Remember, I talked about putting the coil over the motor part of the brain and assessing what comes out by measuring motor activity, the muscles, muscle twitch in the hand. Well, it turns out that you can use that as an index of cortical activity, right? Because you have something to measure, you have an output. And so you can determine the relationship between stimulation and how stimulatable the brain is, right? By measuring its motor output under different circumstances. And so we're going to take advantage of those properties in a couple of different measures that I'm going to talk about, and then show how they apply to FTD as well as to AD. So one set of these measures is intracortical, what's called paired pulse stimulation. So what paired pulse stimulation is you give a tiny pulse, a sub-threshold pulse, one that's not big enough to fire off that motor cortex, right? And then you follow it immediately with one that is. Okay, so bam, bam. And so you can do this at different intervals. You can make the interval very short, 3 milliseconds. You can make the interval a little bit longer, 10 milliseconds. And it turns out that whether you give it the two pulses at a short interval or a slightly longer interval has a different and actually opposite effect on how much motor output that supra threshold pulse actually generates. Right? So that's illustrated here. On its own, the pulse generates a certain kind of motor output, a certain amplitude of motor output. If you give an early, like a very short delay pulse, 3 milliseconds, you actually inhibit the normal level of motor output, right? So this is the red line. It's much lower than the black line. If, on the other hand, you let that delay become a little bit longer, 10 milliseconds, you actually facilitate the output, okay? So this is referred to as short interval intracortical inhibition, right? You're impeding that output, and intracortical facilitation at a longer interval, okay? And these two measures are thought to assess different aspects of cortical function, cortical activity related to different neurotransmitter systems. The ability to inhibit the brain's response is thought to be related to the most prevalent inhibitory neurotransmitter in the brain, GABA. So it's an assay of GABAergic response, whereas this later facilitation, right, excitation, is thought to be reflective of the brain's most prevalent excitatory neurotransmitter or glutamate. So it's an assay of glutamatergic tone. So that you can use these measures, right, to say something about the level of tone of these two neurotransmitters. And it is thought that the GABAergic state and glutamatergic state of the brain is disarrayed in patients with FTD. So we'll come back to that in a second. Now, switching to a different measure, there's another measure called short afferent inhibition, and this involves actually sending a signal up your nerves, right, sort of an afferent signal. So you actually stimulate the body, in this case, the median nerve, so the nerve in your hand, right, and that sends an impulse up, 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 up into the brain, and if you time it right, you can time when the impulse arrives at the brain with when you give your own impulse with TMS, right? And so it turns out if those two events, the timing of the afferent impulse as it gets to your brain and when you're giving TMS, if those two things are timed up so that they're pretty close to one another, right, then you will get inhibition of the motor output, the effect of TMS on motor response. So that is called short afferent inhibition. So you inhibit the outgoing response by giving an afferent stimulation. Okay? And importantly, for reasons that we don't really have time to discuss, that is thought to be related to the cholinergic state of the brain, the state of the neurotransmitter acetylcholine, which is understood to be disordered in patients who have Alzheimer's disease. Right? And so in a recent article, of great interest, these markers were used to disambiguate patients with Alzheimer's disease from those with frontotemporal dementia. So here again, this is an illustration of that, what's referred to as an input-output curve for the short inhibition, short intracortical inhibition and intracortical facilitation. And you can see for the SICI portion of the short interval that patients with FTD had abnormal performance compared to patients with AD and healthy controls, but also on the other end, they also had abnormal performance in intracortical facilitation. So both their GABAergic function and their glutamatergic function, both disordered in patients with FTD. By contrast, if you looked at short afferent inhibition, so these are now your patients with FTD, they look just like your patients with your subjects who are healthy. And here, it's the patients with Alzheimer's disease who have a diminished response to SAI, right? So you've got two different kinds of measures, two ways of measuring brain activity that give you two abnormal results in two patient populations. So what you can do is you can start to look at how sensitive and how specific these markers are at differentiating patients with these disorders versus healthy controls. So these curves, which are referred to as area under the curve, or AUC, right, in these receiver operator curves, the area under the curve is representative of both the sensitivity and the specificity. And you want a test that's sensitive. In other words, it detects the disease when it's there, and specific, meaning it doesn't show up as indicative of the disease when the disease is not there, right? So you can imagine, so this is one minus specificity. So the most specific is over here. The most sensitive is up here. You can imagine that what you want is a test that is as close to, gets as close to this corner of the graph as possible, that is highly sensitive, highly specific. And you can see that the SICI-ICF, right, the short interval intracortical inhibition and intracortical facilitation, that those measures that seem to be abnormal in FTD, that you get, you know, good sensitivity and specificity in for FTD versus healthy controls, not so much for patients with AD. By contrast, for your SAI, you get good sensitivity and specificity for patients with Alzheimer's disease, not so much with your FTD. But then what you can do is you can make a ratio. Let's say you were interested in knowing whether or not your patient with cognitive declines had FTD versus AD. Well, then if you make a ratio that is that measure of FTD relative to that measure of AD, it turns out it gives you a very sensitive and specific response. The sensitivity, the area under the curve, in other words, you know, how much space is covered by this graph, is very high, 0.93, you know, maximum is 1. The sensitivity is in the 90s, the specificity is in the high 80s. If you were to make a call based on the results of that ratio, you'd be 90% accurate. So it provides at least some early promise that in addition to potentially being a therapy, that non-invasive brain stimulation may also be a useful diagnostic tool in these disorders. So just to take a second to talk about current and future directions, you know, it seems like pairing non-invasive brain stimulation with appropriate therapies has some purchase. It seems like there's informative and useful signal there, and it might be promising, certainly in the language disorders, but maybe in other FTLD spectrum disorders as well. You know, I think it's very important for us in the future to look for factors that can predict response to the pairing of non-invasive brain stimulation with therapies. That includes, at least in our research, the severity of the patients who we're administering these therapies in. Biological markers, you know, where is their atrophy? Which proteins or which pathological hallmarks do they have? I think individualization is going to end up being really important in this field, that it seems unlikely, given the variability and the heterogeneity of these disorders, that one size is going to fit all. And it's going to be important to figure out which factors are determinative of how specific individuals need to be stimulated. There is this question, you know, particularly with tDCS, there are ongoing clinical trials right now. Now, the one main clinical trial that I'm thinking of is in MS, but there are ongoing clinical trials in which people are actually receiving stimulation in their homes. And, you know, that begs the question of whether or not these devices are going to move to a place where individuals are going to be treated on an outpatient basis with some type of remote supervision in the long term. And then finally, just to be encouraging of individuals who are thinking about participating in tDCS or TMS research, you know, as has already been noted in our conversation, there are ongoing studies for individuals who are interested in exploring whether non-invasive brain stimulation might be a useful therapy for these disorders. And with that, I'm happy to take any questions in the couple of remaining minutes.
Great, thank you. Well, it's been really fascinating to be introduced to both the kind of the global use of the global technology and what it does, and then the particulars and the very specific detailed information that is being looked at and that needs to be looked at so that we really understand what the potential of these technologies are. You know, I think that the questions that we're left with that people are wondering about are certainly along those lines. And so I think maybe I can summarize them as two that are related. So if you had to summarize in terms of the state of the art, where research is now, what are the main questions that are being explored in order to kind of see if and when these technologies would become therapies that might move to the community? You had mentioned that possibility. And I realize in some ways it's an unfair question, but it seems like a lot of the research is around the location or the focus of the stimulation, the dose, and then to some extent, what are the results that could be expected? So what has to happen on the research side before we can answer the viability of these devices as potential therapies?
Okay, so I think there are two kinds, there are two categories of scientific questions that need to be addressed in order to really explore these as therapies. One is the conventional sort of clinical trials question, right? If you administer these therapies, is there enough signal? How much signal, and by signal I mean, you know, effect of stimulation, how much is there? Is it worth undergoing stimulation? How long does it last? Is it significantly better than, you know, whatever we have or try to administer in terms of behavioral therapies alone, right? And that's going to take placebo-controlled trials of increasing size until we can demonstrate a weight, you know, a burden of proof that supports approval for some form of non-invasive neuromodulation as a therapy. You know, the same way that TMS, you know, underwent developing that burden of proof as a treatment for depression, right? So that's one category. The other category, I think, and this is particularly true of tDCS, is that there has to be a little bit more science into exploring and understanding the relationship between the instrument itself, the tools themselves, and what they do in the brain, and how that relates to what you think you want to get out of brain stimulation. And so that's going to involve studies that explore exactly what you say, like what site should we be stimulating? Because, you know, by the neuroplastic mechanisms you're hoping to induce, like which parts of the brain ought to respond to that? What intensity do you need to employ? Because it's not like turning up the volume on your stereo. I mean, different intensities have different effects in ways that aren't monotonic or predictable. What's the right duration that affects the brain in the right ways? What's the right and importantly, what's the right behavioral therapy to pair with brain stimulation? Because we think that brain stimulation augments neuroplastic processes. Is there a particular set of behaviors you ought to be engaging in at or near the time you get brain stimulation to maximally augment those processes? You know, all these sort of how do we do it right kind of questions, in addition to once we get it right, you know, can we demonstrate that in its optimized form, it has enough therapeutic benefit that it ought to be an approved treatment? So that's how I would answer that.
Great. Thank you. And as an extension of that, you know, the other thing, of course, that everybody's wondering about is there discussion or thought about getting to a point where these therapies, were they to be approved, would be considered or investigated as preventative measures for someone at risk of developing FTD? Is there that kind of discussion happening in the research world, or what would it take to get there?
Well, you know, I don't think that there's been a lot of discussion yet. I think that the consideration, let me say that, I think the consideration of non-invasive neuromodulation in neurodegenerative disease is still a little bit younger than its consideration for other disorders. I think that, by that I mean earlier, I think that the focus is still on patients who are manifesting clinical symptoms, in part because the focus is on addressing the functionality of networks that are understood to be degrading, right? And so, you know, we're talking about inducing specific effects. So if we're talking about preventative care, we'd have to understand more about, well, what networks do we stimulate and why, when we don't have a sense of which one's going to be disordered in which individual, right? I mean, you know, does it make sense to stimulate asymptomatic individuals for, say, non-fluent achromatic PPA, knowing that, well, most individuals don't develop non-fluent achromatic PPA, right? So we'd have to have some sense of how stimulation can actually affect things like cognitive reserve and how it affects different parts of the system relative to what we think is going to happen to the system in the future. And that, I think, is a little bit murkier.
Well, and it seems as though that almost takes us back to the beginning when you mentioned that there are people who are using tCDS in a very general fashion for enhancement of healthy cognitive functioning. But that probably hasn't been researched, so we don't even know how or why that may be beneficial for healthy people. Is that fair to say?
Well, that's exactly right. So there actually is a small but active community of individuals who are stimulating their own brains in the hopes of benefiting their cognition using either devices that are directly marketed to individuals, or in some cases they're actually building their own devices. It turns out that tDCS is not so complicated to develop. And there's a lot we don't know about what the consequences of that are. I mean, if you think about it, the brain is to our knowledge, the single most complicated device in the known universe. It is pretty far-fetched to imagine that if you just stick a plus sign on one end and a minus sign on the other, the only thing that's going to happen is what you want to happen. All right, so I think I think in individuals who are healthy at the time, it's not completely clear to me that whatever cognitive gain they expect to get from stimulation might not be offset by some unexpected change that was actually relatively unwanted. Right, so in the network and subsequently in cognitive function. And there's a little bit of research on that. There's a little bit of research in which individuals getting stimulation to assist with, that improves at least temporarily one cognitive ability, they can demonstrate a change, an unanticipated change in another cognitive ability. So, it's not a mountain of evidence, but there's at least some data there to support that the system is probably more complicated than would be, than would warrant unsupervised treatment.
Right. Well, thank you so much. We've kept you and all of our attendees over time. I think that is a real testament to both your enthusiasm for the topic and for the stimulating conversation around these potential therapies and potential diagnostics in the field. So once again, really, Dr. Roya Hamilton, thank you very much for being with us today. I hope that the presentation's been helpful for everyone who has joined us. We do have a recording. We will post the recording as soon as we're able to and send the link out so people know that they can revisit some of the comments and the questions and the slides, as well as share them more widely with other people who are also interested in these non-invasive techniques in PPA and FTD. So thank you everyone for joining us. Watch for the announcement of our next webinar, and we wish everyone the happiest and safest of holiday seasons. Thank you so much.
Thank you.